Welcome back to Mount Panorama as our coverage continues of the Super Cheap Auto Bathurst 1000 of 2012. The mountain's going to be quiet now after the incredible top 10 shootout session where Will Davison has claimed pole position. Car number six with John McIntyre, so he'll start from P1 for tomorrow's 161 lap. Great race. We are joined by Alan Moffat, Hall of Famer, four-time winner up here. Mark Scaife still with me, six-time winner around here. And the reason why we've got the legends in, we're going to talk you through these top 10 awesome moments. We started with 50, judged down to the 10, and over the last 6 weeks, we've been rolling them out. They will eventually be voted on by the end of this show when it closes, and then tomorrow we'll get the number one awesome moment in 50 years. Moff, great to see you.
Pleasure.
You have been asked ad nauseum about 1977, the famous Ford 1-2 finish, and I don't reckon you get sick of being asked.
No, it's not hard to remember, and certainly it was very exciting on the day. To take one car to Bathurst to qualify and finish is an achievement, but to do that with two cars, and I had a great teammate with Colin Bond. He made it all happen, and we worked in sync, and it was really a fabulous afternoon.
Alan, there was a lot of great drives. I mean, 1970, first solo drive, 1973, had a spin, still won the race. Tell me the best drive of all those. That's the most famous finish. But what was your best drive? At the end of it, you would have said, that from Alan Moffat's personal perspective, what was your best drive?
I was very proud of the 73 win because I had the late, great Pete Gagan as a co-driver, and he knew Bathurst better than I did with the new car. And on practice, he came in and, you know, he stuttered a little bit. And he said, we got a bit of a problem. And I said, oh, yeah, what? And he said, oh, I got a gearbox problem. And I said, well, what is it? And he handed me the gear lever. And I thought, oh, this is the way we're going to start the weekend. But we landed up winning it, and it was a great thrill to win the first 1,000-kilometer race.
Yeah. In Bathurst. Of course, 77 was your fourth and final win. You had Jackie Ickx with you. Colin Bond had Alan Hamilton. A couple of other points out of 77. Indy 500, great. Johnny Rutherford competed that year and was a DNF. It was also the first year bloke called Mike Raymond called his first race around here at Mount Panorama. So wonderful memories. 1979, let's move 2 years down the track. One of the most awesome wins by the King of the Mountain, Peter Perfect. He wins it by six laps. You, Scaife, have called this one of the greatest drives you've ever seen.
Well, if you have a look at the body language, watch him come down through the S's. Watch how on two wheels, watch this into the dipper. Right up on two wheels. This is the lap record on the last lap of the race. So he not only wins the race by six laps, he breaks his own lap record on the last lap. Now that's pretty groovy.
Which he was pretty good at telling everybody as well in case we missed it.
Exactly.
That was Brocky's fourth win as well, and his second with Jimmy Richards, who's going to join us in a moment. 1979 also was the debut of something that was just, I mean, absolutely incredible in the world of television, sports broadcasting, and of course motorsport. It was RaceCam. It debuted right here in 1979 on this network, Channel 7, in car 77 of Peter Williamson and a Toyota Celica.
And he was extraordinary. In the day, he hardly affected his lap time. He could call the whole lap. He had really great chat. And here he is right up behind a Ford Capri of the day. And it was groundbreaking sports coverage, as Matt said, for the Seven Network of the day. And Peter Williamson, as I said, he was the best at it, wasn't he?
He could just
chat. You couldn't chat like that, could you?
Well, being a Toyota dealer, he was fluent in all languages, yes.
Hey, by the way, we heard a bit of commentary as well in the top 10 shootout. I don't know if you guys who were standing by wouldn't have heard it when Shane Van Gisbergen gave us a come on halfway down Conrod Strait. So he was all fired up as well. What are some of the greatest memories outside of those, Alan, that you can think of in the 50-year history of this race, whether they're yours or someone else's?
Well, I remember the first year I came up. Well, Peter and I both came up in 1969, and the Ford team took me out and said, I'll show you the circuit, and they stopped on Skyline. And in those days, there was no barrier on the left. So I thought we were just looking at, there's the pitch, there's the town hall, etc. And I said, well, we better get to the circuit. We've been told we're on a time limit. And they said, well, you're on the circuit. And that truly was the last time I ever looked left across Skyline, because a big drop there. And so, I thought, boy, what's waiting for me?
So 1969, massive year then, because obviously Brock and Alan Moffat their first year.
Yep.
First win for a young bloke called Colin Bond.
Yep.
Thank you. Yes.
In a Holden, in a Monaro.
A Monaro, actually, yes.
Hey, Alan, I'm going to let you go in just a second as we move on through the top 10 moments. But as a Canadian, to be accepted as effectively part of Australian folklore in motorsport racing, how do you judge yourself these days?
I had to wear the new Australian tag for a long time.
Yeah.
And the promoters were quite happy for me to be the guy with the black hat because of the way I spoke.
Yeah.
But I'm very happy to be an Australian citizen today, and Australia's been my home for all my adult life, and it'll continue to be for the rest of my life.
Absolutely. Well, it continues, fantastic, of course, through James, who's driving in the true blue colours tomorrow in car 17. So, mate, great to see you. Thanks
my
for
pleasure.
Riding down memory lane with us, and all the best for young James. You enjoy tomorrow.
Thank you so much.
Fantastic.
Alan Moffat, four-time winner there. Make sure you stay with us. You stay with us as well, mate. You don't want to miss this chat, because Dick Johnson is coming up after the break, and also Jimmy Richards as well. V8supercars.com.au is the website to go to. Follow the links and you can be part of this voting process as we count down the top 10 awesome moments here at Bathurst. Stay with us.
'92 Bathurst was one of the most emotional days, one of the most dangerous days in the history of the event.
Oh, 76 car.
Basically, we'd led the race all day, and as it got to the stage where the rain started coming very, very heavily, and I hit the wall, same spot as Dick hit the rock earlier on in those years, and then I sort of struggled across top of the mountain, and then eventually slid into the pile of cars that were on Conrod Strait.
Oh no! The punters at the top of the hill. This is the kind of send-off they wanted to see for themselves.
Obviously, to get back to the pit area, Escapee came running up and said, "We've won." I went from, you could say, zero to hero.
Because we weren't in a Ford or a Holden, had a pretty adverse effect on the crowd that afternoon.
Mark Scaife and Jim Richards.
Well, I didn't expect the response that we got, but I thought it would be, you know, a little bit noisy. Escapee was lining his pockets with things to throw at the crowd because they were already throwing things at the dais before we got there. Said basically, you know, don't worry about that. We'll go out, we'll have our say, and we'll be off having a beer in no short time.
I'll tell you what, this is going to remain with me for a long time. You're a pack of assholes.
And I don't regret it. Escapee and I left, and we were having a laugh about 30 seconds later.
To go there in 1980 as a privateer team and have a car that was competitive and be on the front row and then lead the race, I found that I was virtually pinching myself in that stage to think that here I am leading, you know, the greatest race in Australia. And then the rock appeared on the road.
Oh, we've had another bang, and is that the
Dick
race?
Johnson. The leader, Dick Johnson. But he has gone into the fence.
Something that one could never imagine had happened.
It was enormous. It was enormous.
And what happened after that was where things kick-started my career, to be quite honest. It was one of those situations where the public sort of started ringing into Channel 7 saying, you know, we want to donate money to basically help this team back on the track.
Dick, the switchboards at all the seven stations across Australia are jammed. Ringing and just genuinely pledging money to help you.
And that gave us a sizeable budget the following year. And go and win Bathurst in 1981 was something that I felt, you know, that we actually paid a little bit back to those people that helped us.
Yeah, of course, the year was 1980. It was actually the year the Commodore debuted here at the Mountain. The VC Commodore it was, and Jimmy Richards and Peter Brock claimed victory that year. But of course, the true blue Ford was all about the headlines, and the man who was behind it, Dick Johnson, joins us to talk about the rock. And Dick, what they say, you know, what doesn't break you makes you, and that was certainly the case there.
Well, it certainly was, mate. And as a matter of fact, it was a fair way into my career. It's not as if it was the first or second race that I'd ever had. No, I'd been trying since 1964 to get somewhere, and you know, that's a fair sort of a while. And I suppose it started my career at about the age that these guys today are retiring.
When you look back at that vision there that we just saw of that emotional time when you were told that the Channel 7 switchboard was flooded with calls and people were calling in, donating money, does that emotion still run through you?
Well, certainly after the way it all transpired and that, and one could never imagine what happened when I got home. It was quite amazing where I had, they didn't go to the mailbox. I had mail vans coming, reversing up to the front door and dumping these big calico bags there that were full of letters and with kids' pocket money and things like that. It was a very emotional time for me.
Sure was. Where's the rock now, mate?
It's in the museum here in the pits at Bathurst.
Absolutely.
Now after that, it'll certainly be in the museum at Stoke, where our workshop is.
You come back in 1981 and you win the great race. You also win it in 89 and 94. But let's talk about 1983 and a certain tree in the shootout. This was just mind-blowing. What do you remember about this?
That was something that happened that, obviously, in qualifying, you try extremely hard and you go close to walls and things like that. And the cars back then weren't as perfect as they are today, so you wouldn't have to make much of a mistake. The tyres at the end of the concrete wall grabbed hold of the steering and broke the steering off, and until then I still hadn't boot into it, and I thought, well, you know, you do these sort of things in qualifying, but once it broke the steering and I landed on that wheel and headed into the trees, I thought, gee, I could be in a bit of trouble here.
All right, mate, well, you're part of Australian motorsport folklore and, of course, Bathurst folklore, three-time champion up here. Thanks for your company today as we relive some memories on the top 10 awesome moments. That's Dick Johnson there, and now we're joined at the panel by Jim Richards, another great seven-time winner here. You won three with Peter Brock, you won three with the bloke next to me, one with Rickard Rydell in the Volvo S40. And, Jim, you own the best victory speech, hands down, of any Australian sportsman, 1992.
Yeah, sometimes I wonder if I'm, famous for that only, you know. But, but listen, that was a spur of the moment thing, obviously. You know, Scafe, you'd egg me on, and
that's not true.
If he had drunk all that beer he had in his pockets,
I don't think he was old enough. When you look at the vision, he doesn't look old enough to drink the beer. But just talk us through this day, mate.
Well, it was a hard day. I mean, it was wet, it was dry, it was wet again, and. And we came across the top of the hill, and well, before we got to the top of the hill, we crashed into the bank. And then, we actually hit the wall, ripped the wheel off it, and continued on down to the main straight where it was absolutely raining harder, obviously. The oil cooler had been severed, so it was dripping oil under the car, then it just slowly waltzed into the bank and into the other cars.
Your memories?
It was just extraordinary because we thought that was the end, meaning we were out of the race. The race had obviously been stopped after the incident out of Forest Elbow. And then everybody in the pit, we were advised that the race was officially stopped, which obviously under that rule, whoever was leading the previous lap is adjudicated the winner. And all of a sudden, we were the winner. So Jim's got out of the car. I've come running up to him and given him the big cuddle of, you know, we've just won this race. And his face was, it went from absolute disaster to just triumph, wasn't it?
No, exactly. No, I thought he was coming down to punch me, but he came out to cuddle.
was what you said pre-planned?
No, no, absolutely not. No, we just went on there, and I was going to say thank you very much and head off and go into the back room. But
he did learn from it, because 10 years on, he went on to call them a pack of very nice people. So 10 years on, he won the race and very nice reaction
just
afterwards.
Just another thing, Jim, is it also true that you taught him how to drink too much beer?
Drink beer and arm wrestle.
It was an incredible year, 1992, the last year of Group A's, and we lost Annie Holm that year as well. And, of course, Godzilla and Nissan GT-R divided the nation. Let's go back 10 years earlier, 1982, and one of those incredible moments of Kevin Bartlett rolling the Camaro, Channel 9 Camaro, up it goes and over it goes. I mean, just extraordinary to take a look at that and just see KB jump out.
Well, it popped the left-hand rear tyre, Matt. You can actually see it. You watch when KB does emerge, he walk over to that tyre, and as the marshal helps him, rescue him out. Now, he walks back, he has a little look, and looks straight back at that wheel, and that wheel there, tyre's flat.
So up under the tree, which we saw some great vision today. Garth Tander went so close to the fence, so many guys in qualifying. It's one of the fastest zones of the circuit. And for the tyre to pop off and turn him around and ultimately end up on your roof was a pretty big moment.
Jim, when you look back at the old vision like that and further back, of course, when you look at the safety standards around here, mate, it is scary.
No, it is. But when you drive here, when my first drive was in 74, and you just came up and it was a racetrack and you were excited. No one thinks they're going to spear off or have an accident. You're too good to drive. You're not going to make a mistake. So you just drive the track as fast as you can and don't worry about the surroundings.
82 is the year that Brock and Perkins won. It was the first time a car carrying race cam actually won the race. And Alan Grice did the first 100-mile average lap around here in the Commodore. So many great memories. Jimmy, it's been great to catch up with you.
Thank you.
Seven-time winner, as we know, and you enjoy your day tomorrow, mate.
Thank you.
Thanks, all righty. We've got v8supercars.com.au is the website. Remember to go to top 10 awesome moments. We're counting down 50 years here at Bathurst. Craig Lowndes, Garth Tander in the studio, standing by to join us right after this.
He holds it together through the chase. And Greg Murphy, listen to the crowd roar.
You know, being able to do something that was as significant as 2003, you know, that sends shivers down my spine still to this day.
He has released the shackles on car 51.
You know, to cross the start-finish line after the shootout and see what flashed up on the dash.
A blistering lap!
Holy smokes!
That's record-breaker!
And that was just like, wow, that's mind-blowing.
Uncharted territory for anybody on the mountain.
But then to drive down the pit lane and see just the floods of all those people that are in those garages, all of them come out and applaud it, that's the bit that will sit with me forever.
Look at that. You will never see that at any other time in Australian motorsport.
Doing the lap was phenomenal, and to be in the car and feel it and remember it and be able to watch it is awesome, but the accolade of having all your peers, you know, forever, that will be the bit that you know, makes it what it was.
Quite simply, the most incredible lap you're ever gonna see.
'06 was always going to be a special year. You know, it was the passing of Peter Brock. We knew that it was going to be a very emotional week of Bathurst. And the Sunday morning, it really hit home. You know, driving his 72 XU1 Tirana around on display lap, all the emotions came flooding back. All the times that, you know, he used to drive into Bathurst with Brock, and he used to look at the crowd, look at, you know, the mountain, and always used to speak so highly of it, so passionate about the place, and how, you know, every year that he went back, that he had a connection with it.
It's time to say farewell to Peter in the way that he would have wanted.
Now, I wanted to start that day because it was going to be a special day, regardless whether we won or not. It was going to be a special day.
And look at this on the inside. This is for the lead of the race, and he's got it.
The battle with Rick at the end of the day, 6.5 hours, is exactly what I needed in the sense of keeping my mind sharp, keeping me focused on what I needed to achieve and what I wanted to achieve.
This will be a huge outpouring of emotion. 10 years in the way.
But then to stand on top of the podium at the end of the day, to get presented with the first inaugural Peter Brock trophy from Phil Brock, his brother, to have our names, knowing our names were going to be the first engraved, you know, that was, and you can see my emotions coming out. It was just one of those unbelievable days.
Yeah, two more of our top 10 awesome moments to get through. Garth Tander and Craig Lowndes join me here. 8 Bathurst titles combined between the two of you. That 2006 obviously has been recognised as one of the top 10 moments. And you've spoken so openly, mate, about the emotion of that day. How did you hold it together?
Well, it was actually, I don't know. Like, we got back to the garage and Roland actually made a point to me and said, look, you know, we can put Jamie in the car, we can start him. I said, no, I want him to start the race. It was one of those things that I wanted to do. Regardless of the end result, I wanted to start the race. We started the race and just things unfolded as the day you know, went on. So for me, it was quite an, you know, as I said, emotional day. It was emotional for all of us. But, you know, then to stand on top of the podium at the end of the day, like, it just, that's when it all came out of me. And I think up until then, the adrenaline was pumping me and keeping me going.
Garth, your memories of that day in 06?
Very short memories for us, because it was over pretty quickly. I actually just pulled the headset on and I could hear Scafie going clutch, 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 and it was melting out the bottom of the bell housing. So I actually left the race. I didn't want to hang around and watch it, so I got in my car and drove home, and I was actually back in Melbourne before the race had finished. I rang out media guy and said, who won? They go, we're still going. So yeah, I didn't even see it finish, but yeah, we were over and out pretty quickly in that one, and which was, you know, obviously disappointing for us. We'd had a fast car all week, and you know, to be on the front row, and we knew it was going to be a big battle all day, and we just couldn't even fire a shot.
Well, let's go back just 12 months ago, one of the most extraordinary finishes we've ever had here. We didn't know what was going to happen until the very final turn. This was you guys going at it after 161 laps and just what was it, 0.23 or something seconds would it separate?
Right here was where I almost made a decision to go with it. And
well, I made a decision there too, that if you were going up the inside, I was turning in anyway.
And there was a fair chance that both of you would have ended up in the fence, correct?
And actually, Greg Murphy comes in third here. He actually commented to both of us. He actually got up me. He said, why didn't you try that? But right here was actually where I was hoping to obviously get the switch back. There was a lot of oil down the on the right-hand side of the track. And I knew at this point right now that it was all over.
GT, when did you breathe a sigh of relief?
Well, I didn't actually breathe a sigh of relief till we crossed the line, but even Lounsey never told me that bit as we came out of the chase, but I basically didn't even look in the mirror after we came out of the chase. If he wanted to shove it up the inside of the last corner, then good luck to him. I was going to break as deep as I could, and whatever happened, happened, and it was enough to get over the line by 0.3 or something like that.
It was an extraordinary day. What did you do after that? I mean, what do you do on the night that you win Bathurst once you get all your media commitments and everything out of the way? I mean, we sort of see you up until about 6 o'clock and say goodbye. What happens thereafter?
Yeah, look, you kept busy with other media and you know, phone stuff and all the rest of it, and it was about 9 o'clock we got back to where we stay, and there was a big team dinner. So had that, and we finished up there about 10:30, and then headed into Bathurst and checked out the nightlife. And there's a big Holden after party in town, so we were in there for a little while.
Well, you will start tomorrow's race from 6th, and Lounsey, you'll start from 9th. Just a super quick one. Are you happy with the car?
Well, I was up until the top 10, but look, that's the top 10. That's the gamble we play.
All right. Well, best of luck for both of you tomorrow, defending your title here with Nick Perkak. We wish you all the very best. So that's it, our top 10 awesome moments. We've counted you through them. Remember, go to v8supercars.com.au. Voting will close in just about a minute's time, and News Limited papers will reveal the winner for you tomorrow morning. So get up early, go and grab the paper, and see which of the moments is the number one after 50 years of celebrating the endurance race here at Mount Panorama. There the details for you in the morning. Just get up, put it on 7, you won't miss a beat. 161 laps. Will Davison will start from pole position. Who will be the champion of 2012? We will find out when we see you tomorrow. Bye for now.